the first people to sing that song, are we? It almost felt like we just jumped in a river of people who have been singing that for centuries. The Spirit of God is alive in that piece of music. And I bet if you studied the history of that song, you would learn something unique about the power of God. He doesn't say you have to be whole and perfect for me to use you. He says you have to be broken and willing. God can take a broken and willing vessel and create a piece of music that changes people's lives. There's something transcendent in the nature of art and poetry and scripture. We believe that God is transcendent in his nature, and so he takes something that is ancient and he plants it in the present to wake us up. And so we're on a bit of a journey to find out what that is. But if I could just live in that moment that we just had forever and ever and ever, I believe that's what being in the presence and the glory of God is like. And we get little glimpses of it on this side. I truly believe it, that there are moments of heaven on earth, but they're previews of what's to come.
Creation sings your glory. Creation sings your glory.
This idea that God is transcendent, why we still sing these hymns that were written years and years and years ago, why do we still resonate with those songs? I believe it's because the Spirit of God is in those pieces of music. So what would happen if we studied the lives of the people who wrote those songs?
Whether it's hymns or poetry books that inspired us, we look at these people and we put them on pedestals and we've created all these things that they have been, and we look at them and we go, we can never do those kinds of things. We see that they had struggles, they had pain, they had doubt. They had all these things that I carry on a day-to-day basis. And God used them to do incredible things.
Would we find that they resonated with our own stories? Would we see that their brokenness was the same as our brokenness? And would we find that the faith and the pursuit of God is the same then as it is today?
Guys, what did we do? Come on up, Zach. For everybody that doesn't know, this is a portion of the Poets and Saints crew, what you just saw. This is a portion of the crew. Zach, over here, you want to introduce yourself?
Yeah. Hi, I'm Zach Pritchard.
Can you say what you did?
Yeah, I'm a filmmaker and went on a trip with these guys and just filmed everything that they did for like 2 weeks in Europe. And it was powerful. It was amazing. We saw, obviously, some incredible things, but have spent the last year and a half coming up with some cool ideas of how to present that material. Mm-hmm. So, yeah, that's what I did.
We were just talking the other day, I loved about how you would be standing there with us without your camera, and then all of a sudden you would have your camera. Like, there's footage of us sitting in our pajamas, you know, because yeah. You just popped up,
sorry,
you know, with a camera. But it was awesome because you knew there was a moment there.
Yeah, totally. I mean, I think that, you know, as you'll find out, like, that's the whole point with this thing, is that, you know, we're in these beautiful places and we're studying these, you know, figures that we've heard their names for years and they've been studied for centuries, but our reaction to them is what was important. Mm. You know, we're not, you know, some of it's informative for sure, but I think the heart of this project is watching you guys react to touching a sculpture and being in a cathedral and you know, sitting having dinner in the Eagle and Child where C.S. Lewis would write stories, you know, like those, there's something sacred about those places. Mm-hmm. And we just reacted to those things.
Mm-hmm. Leslie, talking about the idea, concept, the seed, would you go all the way back to the beginning, that journal entry, that moment?
November 20th, 2014. I actually looked at it the other day. I was like, when did this happen? I was reading a book called Walking on Water by Madeline L'Engle. All of you creative types, even non-creatives, it's an amazing book. And most of us know Madeline L'Engle from A Wrinkle in Time. Anybody have to read that book? So good. So this is a book just to creatives. It's really to the creative process. And in this particular section, she was quoting the stage play Our Town and this interaction that two characters have. And one of the characters says, does anyone ever experience life as they live it? And the response was, no. Well, saints and poets do. Some of them, maybe. You know, like, really this, like, I don't know. Maybe these two groups of people do. And she goes on to talk about how and why to this two groups of people, poets and saints, how were they able to experience the transcendent nature of God? And in the video, why do we still sing hymns? All Creatures of Our Guide and King, written by St. Francis. Why do we still sing that? What about it resonates with us? And what moves in our community and why? And so it just kind of landed on me that day. And I remember a couple days later sitting with David and going, what if we wrote a record that was just studying the lives of these two groups of people. We just picked some of our favorites and wrote songs. And that was a project enough in itself. Like, we've never done anything conceptual. It's always been, how do we write songs for journey? And but hymns really resonate with this family, so we thought, wouldn't it be cool if we could write songs for this family from these stories? And as all crazy ideas do, it snowballed. Sat with Brett one day, and we started talking about trips to Europe, and walked out of our office and ran into Jamie, and he was like, I'm going to Europe next summer. It's like, great, let's all go. And then it just turned into this crazy idea of, what if we brought cameras, and what if we did a small group DVD, and what if? And there are enough crazy people that believe in our crazy ideas that it came to fruition. And there's a book and a DVD and a CD and a small group curriculum, and it's wild.
And even as a church, Jamie, just right after that, we were like, let's do a season on church history. Yeah. And it's crazy.
The timing
of
it all was pretty wild.
Yeah. Why don't you, David, talk about the people that came on the trip? Because I think that's really unique.
So, obviously, us up here, Sarah included, and we brought our spouses with us. We had Thomas and my wife, Natalie. And then we had our manager and his wife, Chris and Bria. And then we had the twins at some point. We had Ashton at some point. We had Kara. We had, is that it?
Matt
Underwood. So another guy that we had with us. And I mean, it was such a great group of people that represented a bunch of different areas. You know, Thomas and Nat are both teachers. Bria is a small business owner and a mom, so it just covered so much ground with the conversations that we would have after the fact of taking in all this stuff all day long, and just the perspectives that we were able to all bring to the table was something really, really cool, and something we wouldn't have got if it would have just been all of us sitting up there. And so we had a lot of fun. We laughed a lot. We listened to a lot of music, and just told stories. And it was an adventure that we'll always remember.
One of the things I loved about it is because of all the people that were there from Journey, it actually was a great representation. Like, so many villages were mentioned, and people in my village, other people that go to Journey were mentioned so many times. And you can even see that in our curriculum when we'd be talking. I remember underneath the tree talking about George MacDonald, like, other people that weren't even on the trip were being mentioned while we're sitting in London under a tree, you know, in the curriculum. Jamie, talk about all of the items that came out of this and what you guys see the purpose being for all of that.
Well, I guess some time ago, I mean, honestly, it's part of the early days of our church, which, by the way, quick question, how many of you ever visited or were with us when we were in Building 8 in the factory? Would you raise your hand real quick? We wanted to apologize for having no polls today. I know that's disappointing, but we did get a space at least closer in size. It's from those earliest days of Journey's church plant, we felt a calling to be agitators. both for ourselves and for the church at large. How could we be a prophetic voice, maybe even an annoying voice, to the church that kept us on our toes, that prevented a certain level of comfort? And so when this project started to unfold, and the fact that our publishers would get behind us and, you know, risk sending us to Europe, all those things, you know, these publishers in Colorado Springs, that they would believe in this thing so much and get behind it, it became apparent that God was up to something in it. And the responsibility for us was, how do we just be conduits of whatever God is up to? And the thing that became really clear when we did our church history series, for those of you who are around for that, if you remember the day on St. Patrick, those of you here, and I was like, how many of you on St. Patrick's Day celebrate the fact that Patrick took the gospel to the first unreached people group outside of the church? How many of you guys just pause for a moment on Patrick to sort of, you know, that I think one hand went up that day. But lots of people put up shamrocks and drink green beer and whatever. Like, what happened? We missed something about the life of Patrick. And that really became a catalyst for us to go, what don't we know? As Leslie said about Francis and how he's impacted the world and culture. We actually are still singing things and reading lyrics. And so is there a way for us to bring this ancient heritage, really this display of our faith, back to the present and hold it up to the church and say, hey, can you look back for a second and see that there's a real beauty? We sometimes, especially, you know, coming up to November, are really good about identifying our different positions, how we see differently about life, what divides us. But what if we went back and identified what unites us? So in this project, you have John Calvin and St. Therese. You have Martin Luther and George MacDonald and St. Francis. Like, you have these Protestant reformers and these, like, Catholic pillars. But there were these things they held in common, and they all revolved around Jesus. So our hope has been, and it feels like it's starting to, you know, there's this energy behind it. Our hope has been, could we somehow display to the world we could be unified if we brought it all back to Jesus? If it was less important to be right and more important to be loving. And so with all these incredible artisans on board, and you got a little taste of what Zach did here, but the DVD thing was kind of like a bonus, like, hey, what if we make a small group curriculum? And instead of a talking head, it was all of us in the moment, as Zach said, thinking about how we were impacted. And Zach captures it with these epic shots, and it's unlike a small group curriculum we've ever seen. And just to watch all these people put their gifts into this thing. So as we said, there's music. And there it is right there. Yeah. So there's a whole curriculum project. So villages, this is like for your village, there's a whole project right here. And there is a, hold that for me. Or, thank you, David. But there's a, like, there's 7 weeks of like your quiet time devotionals that go along with, and once a week over the course of those 7 weeks, getting together as a group, discussing some of these lives, but talking about how it relates to your life today in these moments. There's a book that, there's a memoir that kind of, it tell, if you're ever like, hey, I wonder what was behind that song. So there's a book that tells the story of our trip and
that
what
Jamie
happened
wrote.
Along the
we
way.
We didn't write the book, Jamie. Thank God.
And in the book, there's these snapshots of each of these historical figures and kind of some spiritual formation around that. There's the DVD, and then, of course, there's the music. What's really special about this for me, though, I don't know how many projects are like this, but there's a song that goes along with each person. So, forget that. I'll just say that. So if you read, like, a chapter on St. Therese, there's a song that goes with St. Therese. So you could literally listen. Each of their songs goes with one of the poets or saints. So the whole thing has a lot of layers to it. Of course, it was for our own church, thinking about how, I mean, we're writing the questions, thinking about you guys going, well, what our villages like to ask each other. And then, of course, we're thinking about other churches and thinking, this is going to be really interesting when they have to answer some of these questions that are pretty normal for us, but not necessarily normal for a lot of other church experiences, because we're talking about brokenness or vulnerability and all these things about our stories. So the primary purpose for today was to go, God gave us a gift. We really believe that. Would you pray with us as we try and agitate the larger church and hopefully cause them to ask questions. I wrote in my journal in 2006, God, would you always make us a church that stays uncomfortable?
Thanks, Jamie.
Would we always have to live by faith and never get too comfortable where we are? I've attempted to go and delete that from my journal. And God has answered that prayer. But, you know, I think that's part of it. Like, this craziness of what we're going through, it really keeps us on our toes. And I think as a result of that, not just us, but so many of you who are out in the church world throughout the week, throughout the months, I don't know why God has formed our story this way, but a lot of us are, he keeps us kind of in this place where we have to trust, and then we just keep passing that story along. And so if that's part of our story that we're supposed to, the word agitate just keeps coming to mind, we're just supposed to poke and prod and ask good questions to the broader church, then we want to be willing to do it and walk in faith. And so you're going to be seeing all kinds of stuff, you know, in, you know, out, and we wanted to let you guys know first and be praying with us and be a part of it, and hopefully the experience of these pieces of hopefully art will be meaningful to you, especially in your villages.
Is anything else anybody want to say? Anything surprising on the trip that you thought, wow, I went into the trip and I was expecting one thing, but anything else?
There can be tons of stuff. We'll be taking the entire service if we do this. I mean, I don't know. I mean, I think it was just, for me, I'm a person who learns by being able to put my hands on things and to be able to see it and to be able to go into these spaces and to be able to take it in. I've never been a huge reader. I've never been a huge guy that does a ton of study. And for me to be able to go and to experience this in this way was something to me that gave so much life. And I feel like we were able to capture that in a way that if you are that person, if you're that person that is difficult to do those kinds of things, that you're going to find something in this stuff as well. When you go through the participant's guide, when you look at pictures, when you look at paintings, and you're prompted to respond to these things, I feel like your heart's going to be stirred in new ways that it hasn't been. And it's just the whole, all the things have been laid out so beautifully and so intentional that I feel like that no matter where you are, if this is something that you normally do or if this is something that would be brand new to you, that you could be able to get something from this just as much. So we're just real proud of it and really think it's something really awesome. So,
I would say for myself, looking at the different people's lives, it was awesome to see how creatively they created a new life, because the system that they lived in, whatever it was, said you had to be a certain way. And these people who weren't like creatives when you think like painters necessarily, they were just creative in the way that they lived. They said, we've got to do something differently. And it changed history. And so I'm excited knowing, like, this is a creative group of people that gather at Journey. There are people that look at family differently and they say, we're not just going to have people that, babies that come from our wombs, we're going to adopt. We're going to go to Africa and adopt. We're going to, you know, adopt here in the U.S. We have people that look at life differently and creatively. And so it's exciting to hand this project over and go, look at the people in the past that are in agreement with the way that you guys are living right now. Yes. And let's all link arms together and keep living life creatively in this God, Christ-following way.
Amen.
I'd love to pray over the project, and they're going to be touring this fall. And I'd just love to pray over you guys and the project and it going out and encouraging people in that same way all over the country. Jesus, I thank you for this group of people and for the work that you've done, the little tiny seeds that you planted years ago that led to this moment where there is a packaged product. Lord, we can see all these names on this product getting finished, but we know that it's truly your name that is the reason that it's accomplished, and we're thankful for that. Lord, we pray that there will be people all over the country that see themselves as the poets and the saints that you've created them to be. And they will be encouraged to live big God lives creatively. That they'll step away from the way that the world says that they have to live. and they'll listen to the unique way that you say to live, and they'll be bold and encouraged by it. Jesus, we love you, and we're thankful for your freedom. Amen.
Amen. Amen. Thank you, Sarah. Yeah, thank you. David said that he said, you know, I'm not a reader, I'm not, but I'll tell you, those of you who are musicians in particular, producers, you'll appreciate this. If when you listen to the music and you listen to the percussion, like one of the guys, his name is William Cooper, we went into his house, this is like a museum. So when you go up into his house, there, you know, it's like all these things, like his shoes are there and stuff like that. So David takes his hairbrush and creates percussion. I'm not lying to you. William Cooper's hairbrush is part of the percussion on the album. He's got this little machine he's recording. So, like, the sounds on the album are literally from some of the places. So, to me, he's like, well, I'm not a reader. No, he brings this other genius to this. So, there's so many layers to it. I just pray it blesses you guys and is meaningful. And so, we thought we'd take today and talk about one of these guys from our history and how he affected. Kind of a little bit of his story. We love stories. And then how he's affected Christianity, honestly, how he's affected you and me. If you have looked at your watch and you've ever considered time, then you were probably affected by this guy. He's helped determine and kind of articulate our construct of time. This is one of the guys who's just really in the framework of eternity and who God is. So let me open up with a passage, and then I'm going to close with a passage. Usually I'll kind of start with a text. We'll unpack that a little bit. But I'm going to give you one verse, but then I'm going to close with what I would call kind of our grounding text for today and use it kind of in reflection of the conversation and the story of this old saint. First, a verse from the Old Testament written by a man of wisdom, Ecclesiastes chapter 3, verse 11. God has also set eternity in the human heart. Yet no one can fathom what God has done from beginning to end. So let me ask you this question. This phrase, God has set eternity in the human heart. Do you feel that? Have there been moments that you sense that you're connected to more? For when I talk to guys in particular, one of the places this happens with a lot of guys, I don't know, ladies, I'm sure it happens with you guys too, but just my conversation with men, when they get out into the wilderness, countless guys, we're talking stories, they're hunting, they're hiking, whatever, have told me, when I'm out, especially when they're alone, when I'm out in the wilderness alone, I don't know, there's just something I recognize how small I am, and that there's more going on than I'm aware of. I realize what little control I actually have. With women, I often get this kind of a feeling when it comes to parenting, the process of carrying a child, then the birth of that child. And it happens for us in lots of different places, but what are the moments where you would go, that phrase, eternity in the human heart, uh-huh. I get that. There's more to the story than just the material world. I get that I'm an eternal being. And there are moments at least where I have connected with the transcendent. Because this is where we're going. Now, for those of you who've come from a Catholic faith heritage, you might remember that today, August 28th, is the feast day for Saint Augustine. So if you come from a Catholic faith heritage, today's the feast day. What that typically means is if you're in a Catholic experience, we mentioned St. Augustine, maybe say a few words about him, maybe some of the readings from his writings. In our case, we're going to tell this whole story. So let me give you a little bit about this guy, St. Augustine or Augustine. People pronounce it both ways. But his is a life that is worth remembering because he's impacted us in many ways. So, born in North Africa to a pagan Roman official and Christian mother named Monica. Now, that's important. So, his dad was not a follower of Jesus. His mother was. Some of you have grown up in a home where you know that experience. One parent followed Jesus, one parent didn't. And the conflict that kind of arises. This is a long time ago. It's 354 AD. So just a little over 300 years after Christ was born, and I kind of love this because I'm gonna highlight a couple like other people along historical timeline, and I want you to watch a thread that continues throughout humanity. And of course, my hope is to portray for you to recognize that this is a human, this thing about eternity in the human heart, like this is a human condition. It's part of all of us. It doesn't matter when you lived or where you lived. But Augustine, when he was young, he, as we would say, wanted to sow his wild oats. His mother, being a Christian, was like, son, I want you to be really careful about how you live your life. Augustine was like, mom, you know, I'm not, the phrase he uses is just womanish advice. He didn't listen. So Augustine spends he winds up moving to Carthage. Do we got an image of that? He winds up moving to Carthage. Just look at a little framework for the ancient world. It's a port city, and I mean the place is rocking. So picture New York, picture LA, the town is happening. And so he moves to this city and he decides, I am going to pursue and indulge in everything I can. And so the place in particular that he indulged the most was sexually. So this was a guy who went after everything. So, I mean, like, he's the guy who would have loved Vegas. Like, every opportunity he had to something that appealed to his sexual, he went after. And he talks about this at length. What's interesting is he tells his own story later on in a book called Confessions. And he's sitting and he's dictating the book. So if you ever decide, I'm just in the mood to read a book from 354 AD, the book is dictated. He's dictating, and he's on his knees, actually, most of the time, kind of in prayer. And he's just going, oh, I remember this about my life. Well, this isn't my story. So you want to talk about a guy who was modeling vulnerability. He goes back through his whole story to say, there was something missing in my life, and I did everything I could to fulfill that longing in my soul. And so a lot of his story really took place in this city in Carthage. He's a smart guy, though. So much so that someone notices, he doesn't have the money to go to school, not really to a high-end school, but somebody notices and becomes a patron and kind of gives him what we would call a scholarship to go to a university. And so he, in university from our context, so he goes to school and he starts playing around in these other philosophies. He is now, his sexual quests have not stopped, but he's now in this intense pursuit also of the mind. Maybe I can figure something out. I can philosophize enough to understand what gives human life deep meaning. Now, what's interesting is I would assume that there are folks in here that have gone one of these two directions. You've said, yeah, I got this longing thing inside, and I've pursued whatever I could to fulfill my kind of a hedonistic quest. I got to satiate my desires. Or maybe for you, you're the cognitive thing. You're an intellectual. You love what scratches your brain, and you love to read and devour and study. And maybe I can come up with a philosophy that helps best describe why I'm here. We all wrestle with purpose. So Augustine wrestled with multiple different things. He was affected by a number of different books. I go into much greater detail of this in the book itself. But at 20 years old, Augustine finally returns home, back to North Africa, and he becomes a teacher. There's the death of a friend. It deeply affects him. He's back to really questioning again. He wants to apply himself to rhetoric, which is the art of communication and persuasion. How do I learn how to persuade people through the art of communication? But he's frustrated because each time he goes to teach, his students, they're not good students. Students, they're unruly. He goes to Milan, Italy, he spends some time there. He spends some time in Rome. In Milan, however, his life is deeply impacted because there's a bishop there. In our context, he'd be a pastor of a church, and he was known to be a great communicator. He was also very intelligent. So Augustine is interested. This other man's name is Ambrose, and so one day he goes to like a church service. He listens, and he's affected by the man's teaching. There's something here. He can't get a hold. At the end of the service, he walks down front. He says a few words to the bishop, and there's something about that brief connection that's meaningful. And sometime later, Ambrose winds up taking him under his wing, and Augustine begins to unpack and deconstruct some of the philosophy that he had built about life and eternity. And he begins to move into a position where he starts contemplating Christianity. Now, Augustine is famous for this phrase, "Lord, give me chastity, but not yet." He's reflective of so many of us. He's being drawn to Christ. He recognizes that he needs something. He's beginning to awaken to the fact that Jesus is the only one who will save his soul, but he's still interested still in sex. So he's still after it. Now, eventually what happens is he winds up living with a woman and having a child with her. And this, the child, I think, probably grows to teenage years. They're together. It's all kinds of struggles as he continues to try and figure out what he's supposed to do about quenching this deep need. And some friends come along and they tell him a story. And the story is about two other people, much like him, really intellectual, really trying to figure out philosophy, who are also trying to satiate whatever, you know, pleasure, you know, is kind of in front of them. And as the story goes, his friend is telling me, they're sitting in a rented room where he was teaching, I think it's in Milan at the time. And he's sitting in the room, and his friend starts telling this story. He goes, "I got to tell you, I'm with these two guys, and they told me how they came to Jesus. They were loaded down by guilt and shame. There was no way to shake it. The nothing satiated any of their deep down desires. They pursued it. The pleasure thing didn't work. Philosophy didn't work." And Augustine is listening to their story. This man tell their story, and it's deeply affecting him. It's bringing stuff up. Have you ever listened to someone's story and quickly identified and went, "Oh my gosh, I just totally know what you're talking about"? Have you ever watched a movie and you've seen in the character and been like, you're like, "Yes, I get that. I feel that"? Have you ever read in a book, an author says something, you're like, "I didn't know how to put it into words, but that's how I've always felt"? It's that moment for Augustine. He's listening to someone else's story, and two things are happening. The shame that he's not been able to reconcile keeps coming up in him, and the hope of salvation also keeps, and the two are competing internally. He finally, they finish the story. He can't handle it anymore. He runs out of the house. Now, again, he's been wrestling for some time, but there's this culminating moment. So on an autumn day in AD 386, at 32 years old, Augustine, agitated in soul and feeling the violence of shame, runs outside and collapses under a tree. While he's sitting there, for the first time in his life, he actually addresses God. All of his conversations have been about God. This is the first time he actually addresses God. And here's his opening phrase for the first time, which he knows in his mind is really saying, "Now I'm acknowledging there," because as soon as you acknowledge, those of you who have come through an atheistic or agnostic path, you know, the challenge with that is the truth is, if you're an atheist, as soon as you want to argue that there is no God, it's problematic. If you're going to argue that there is no God, the very fact that you have a concept of God becomes problematic in arguing that there isn't one, which is another philosophical conversation. But as soon as you acknowledge God, then you're like, okay, so he's real. Now you suddenly have to live in the tension. Well, how are you going to relate to a divine being? You're going to have to form up a structure of how you're going to relate to something that's divine and has greater control than you do. Augustine knows this. In this moment, he says, here's his line, "How long, Lord, will you be angry with me forever?" Now, what's coming up at him? All that shame, all the failures, all the disgusting moments of his life, all the things that he somehow knew were wrong and yet still wanted to go after it. In this moment, have you had that? Have you ever had that feeling where your shame is so overwhelming? I have. Your shame is so overwhelming that, like, you start contemplating, what's my way out of this? Because I can't keep living. This is so overwhelming. It's this moment for Augustine. This is why, by the way, when people talk about a moment of salvation, people often go to, "This was a place where I surrendered and I finally said, I can't do it anymore, God." That's the first step of the 12 steps is, "I am powerless." That's the road to recovery. The first step of recognizing I need help is, "I am powerless to change my circumstances." And Augustine comes to this moment. He says, "How long will you be angry?" He's feeling this deep despondency. and he hears a voice, a child's voice. We don't know if it actually happened or if it was an angelic voice or if it was the voice of the Holy Spirit. All he says is he hears a voice, maybe coming from across the fence of his rented home. All he hears is a voice, and he says it's kind of a sing-song voice, almost like a little child's rhythm in a song. And all he hears is, "Take it and read. Take it and read." He's outside, "Take it and read." There's no book outside. He walks back into his home, and someone had given him a collection of Paul's letters. So it wasn't in, you know, what we call the Bible today. It was just a portion of it, just Paul's letters that were bound. And in it, he takes the thing and he opens it up to Romans. And the Spirit of God convicts him straight to the heart, to the core. And historians have said it becomes one of the most dramatic conversions to Christ ever recorded. Here was a man, in a lot like the Apostle Paul, running the opposite direction. And yet through the teaching of God's word, through the stories of other people coming to faith, interacting with his own shame, finally coming to place to a surrender, Augustine comes to faith. He's baptized and he begins to devote his time studying scripture. Now, what do we say all the time? God redeems all things, right? So here you have this guy who spent most of his life studying and understanding things. So he just applies now this really fine-tuned intellect to an understanding of the Word of God. And he thinks, the only way I can live now would be to be completely celibate, and maybe I'll live a monastic life. And he moves back to North Africa. And as is typical with God, how many of you, maybe you get into this place, you're in a good place with God, and you get to this place and you're like, wow, okay, man, I've dropped the shame off. I have this new sense of orientation to the world. I can trust God. I feel better. Like, there's goodness and peace like I haven't known before. And you, it kind of looks like the next few steps are clear. And that's how it is for Augustine. Like, oh yeah, I'm going to dedicate my life to God. And so here he goes. He's going to go dedicate his life to God. He actually cuts the relationship off with the woman and the boy. Arguably not the right decision, but it's all he knows at the time. So he thinks, well, I guess I'm gonna. He kind of swings the pendulum. Well, I'm just gonna be celibate, and so he moves to North Africa. And I'm gonna maybe live a monastic life if I'm just gonna study, and I'm gonna maybe help other people on their quest, just like mine. And he's traveling, and he winds up stopping by essentially a local church, and the people there are like, "Hey, our pastor's not here anymore. Would you help out?" "Oh no, no, no. I know what I'm doing. I'm going off to study. I'm just going to study because I got a thing, and I've been, this part of my story, and I don't know Jesus, and that, and I'm going." "And well, just maybe for a little bit. Could you just, kind of an interim thing, could you come on and help us with this?" So, well, yeah, all right. He never leaves. So he becomes the Bishop of Hippo, is the name of the city, which is really just pretty close to Carthage there along the North African coast on the Mediterranean. And there he spends the rest of his life. And I would argue, it's interesting because in this story there are multiple people, John Calvin's another one, who had the intention to just go spend their lives like in a room studying for the rest of their lives, and instead God forced them to be a pastor. And I don't know what it is about being a pastor. Maybe God just forces us to do it sometimes. But those of you, you know the vocation. Like, maybe there's a thing and you're like, "Do I have to do this?" And God goes, "Yeah." And you're like, "But this would just seem easier." And God goes, "No. Like, that would be easier. That's the shortcut. Like, I'm actually going to make you do the hard thing." And so this is Augustine's story. And here's what I believe is true. Had Augustine just gone off and just wrote books and wrote treatises on religion and his thoughts and philosophizing about whatever, I actually don't know that he would have captured the spirit of what it means to follow Jesus. As Sarah mentioned, and I think Zach did when he was talking about the filmmaking process, why? Because our faith is not meant to live in isolation. To truly understand our faith, we have to live in the friction of relationships. I use the word friction on purpose. When we rub up against each other, sometimes there's this wonderful energy, and we're like, "Man, I just feel so connected and loved by my village." And sometimes you go home and you're like, "Honey, that guy drives me crazy. Is there like another village option?" Because relationships are hard. They're really hard. They take a lot of work and a lot of effort. And I actually think God calling Augustine to be a pastor was the thing that allowed him to see faith in a purer light and to understand how the truths of Christianity actually are applied to life. This is why I have this great appreciation for practitioners. There are lots of theorists. Have you ever read a blogger who's got lots of utopian ideas about how we should live as believers? And you're like, probably you should leave your cabin at least once every 3 years. Because that's a great idea. But have you spent time with another human being? Like, I have a little of that prophet in me. I mean, let's agitate. You know, let's not ever be satisfied with the status quo. God is taking us somewhere. Let's stay in movement. Let's stay in motion. But I'm also a pragmatist. Like, life is hard. And there are different seasons. And this book is not just a set of doctrines. This is a book full of stories of people. And the people that God uses are pretty messed up. I mean, Augustine is pretty, we couldn't be like, hey, we're going to show the story of Augustine, everybody. This is great because we're a church. He's one of our founding fathers. So this is Augustine in his 20s. We couldn't watch it here. Be like, honey. This is like one of the heroes of the faith, Saint Augustine. It's the case with all of us. Like, nobody wants their life shown up on the screen. I don't know if any of you came from this kind of faith background. When I grew up, there, these little tracks they would like leave at the restaurant, and somebody like drew weird pictures. There are lots of tracks about hell. I just remember that. But one of them was, just get ready because they're going to show the whole movie of your life as soon as you get up to heaven, and it's going to be awesome. And I remember being like, I don't want to show the movie of my life when I get to heaven. Like, does anybody have another track? Is there like a one with flowers? We are all broken and redeemed. And Augustine is this great picture of this. So that's the summary of his life. And here was a dominant struggle from before he knew Christ, what led him to Christ, and what he still wrestled with afterwards. This is very important. This is what I'm hoping will be the takeaway for today. It revolves around this word, longing. Augustine says this. This is what he writes. At times, this is part of his prayer. At times, God, you admit me into feelings of deep sweetness, honeyed I know not how, which, were they made complete, would make this life something beyond this life. And you've heard me talk a lot about the kingdom of God here. This is kind of a little bit of what he's describing. God, there are these moments on earth that I feel this connection with you that is beyond words. It's transcendent. I sense something. I feel something. And he says, if it actually was completed, this life would be something beyond this life. He's recognizing, because of the brokenness in this world, on this side of heaven, I actually can't fully experience it. If I did, I would have transitioned into the next life. It doesn't get completed until after we die. By the way, that's why a Christian funeral is such a celebration, because it's a little bit, it's sad for us when a believer dies, but the celebration is completed for them now. There's no little tastes anymore. It's full on. They're full on in eternity in an ever-present connection with God. There's no little tastes. But this is what he's saying. And then, now let's see if this relates to you. But then I toppled back to earth, weighted with heavy burdens. How many of you have had a moment with God? Sometimes we call it a mountaintop experience. And then you topple back to earth. Have you had that? Maybe you could even go back to when you were a teenager. There was a camp experience. You had this experience as a child. Maybe it was a moment on a Sunday, man. You just sense the Spirit of God was deeply affecting you, and somehow this tear kind of leaks out, and you're like, "Wow, I'm connecting with the divine in a really special way." And God, and maybe you even determine, "Yes, things are going to be different now." And Sunday about 5 o'clock, you topple back to earth with heavy burdens. So great is compulsion's heavy baggage. He's talking about the compulsion of the flesh. You still feel this heaviness because your flesh has this compulsion to deviate and be obsessed with itself. It's my pride. The lust is still very real. No, my jealousy is taking over. He's saying, so great is compulsion's heavy baggage. So he says, here I can abide, but I don't wish to. I don't want to stay in the flesh. There, the foretaste of glory divine, there I wish to abide, but I cannot. It's miserable either way. Do you know that feeling? Have you had the, God, just take me now, seriously? 1943 A.D., C.S. Lewis, also someone you'll find in the book. If I find in myself a desire which no experience in this world can satisfy, the most probable explanation is that I was made for another world. 1970 A.D., Jewish rabbi, Abraham Joshua Heschel. In every man's life, there are moments when there is a lifting of the veil at the horizon of the known. I love this guy's writing. It's opening a sight of the eternal. But such experiences are rare events. To some people, they are shooting stars, passing and unremembered. In others, they kindle a light that is never quenched. The remembrance of that experience and the loyalty to the response of that moment are the forces that sustain our faith. If there was this moment for you, I don't care if you were 12 or if it was last week, would you draw it up? You go, I can't totally feel it again. Okay, but would you allow yourself to go back to it and not let it be a shooting star that's unremembered? But would you go back to that spark and know that if you fan that spark, there's an opportunity for a flame to come back? For that longing to be revived, for the pursuit of God to be real. That this life is not something we check in and check out. You're not here this morning just because, we're in a new location and we should do a church thing, but you go, no. I've gathered with my family in this moment, spiritual body, or I'm visiting this family to see what they're all about. Why? So that I somehow can give my life to the glory of God. So that I can know him and be known by him. It's what sustains our faith. 2006 AD, American psychiatrist Gerald May, he writes this. My spiritual life was deepening. I was feeling an increasingly passionate yearning for something. I called it my longing for God. And of course, that's what all our deepest longings really are. But I could just as well have said it was a longing for love. For union, for fully being in life, for being vitally connected with everything. It was always with me. Nothing satisfied it, and sometimes, quite frequently, in fact, it seemed unbearable. One of the reasons we don't allow ourselves to feel this longing is because it's mixed with beauty and sadness. The beauty that this is real and I'm deeply loved, and the sadness that there's still a not yet. It can't quite be finished off. And this is where when I say we're meant to live in the tension, we're meant to live in the tension. This deep connection and intimacy with God. This longing for things to be made right is an echo from eternity. It's a huge billboard sign, an important reminder. We're right to wish for more. We're right to search for answers to our questions. We're right to expect something beyond death. We're right to scream about its absence here on earth. We're right to weep over its delay. It's not okay. It's not only okay to have a longing for justice, pleasure, and fulfillment in its appropriate place, but it would be a tragedy to live without it. If you cannot connect with this longing, then
then would you travel to an interior place that is beneath the self? Would you be awakened to the cry of your soul? In the earliest days of Journey, we came up with this phrase that was kind of a, here's our kind of a standing kind of vision statement. Could we dwell in soul environments, sharing the love story of Jesus with the world? Eugene Peterson describes soul this way. He says, soul is the most personal term we have for who we are. Like, who are you? And who really knows you? And do you know yourself? The term soul is an assertion of wholeness, the totality of what it means to be a human being. Self is the soul minus God. You'll know when you interact with someone who's connected to their soul, because you'll sense something about them. There's something real. There's something. There's a depth. There's a recognition that they're connected to something. And you'll know when you meet with someone who is just a self, because there's a minus God part to it. And they're, all their accolades are about them. They can't, they're terrible listeners. They're obsessed with themselves. Their pride and jealousy just kind of droops over them. They're missing God. Self is what is left of soul when all the transcendence and intimacy is squeezed out. And finally, 975 BC. So we're moving about 1,000 years before Jesus. It's quite a span. Now we've covered about 3,000 years of human beings. Psalm 63, verse 1. O God, you are my God, and earnestly I seek you. My soul thirsts for you. My body longs for you in a dry and weary land where there is no water. But I've tasted. I've seen you in your sanctuary and beheld your power in glory. If it was just in the birth of my child, if it was just in the connection that moment in the village, if it was just when I served that homeless man, if it was just in that brief interaction with my dad, whatever the thing is, I tasted, I saw your power and your glory. And because your love is actually better than life itself, my lips will glorify you. I'm compelled to sing. I have to speak. I cannot keep it in. I will praise you as long as I live. And in your name, I will lift up my hands. My soul will be satisfied, as with the richest of foods, with singing lips, my mouth will praise you. On my bed, instead of lost in a cycle of anxiety, I remember you. I think of you through the watches of the night. Because you are my help, I sing in the shadow of your wings. My soul clings to you, and your right hand upholds me. Would you bow your heads and close your eyes for just a moment? Stare at the ground. If you're journaling, keep journaling. Just a place of focus, because I want to leave you with two more thoughts. If you have ever felt that longing, ever, something in deep interior place, I want to give words to it. It's the allure of divine love. It's different than lust. It's different than just that primal craving for pleasure. There's a subtlety to it. It's different. It's an allure of divine love where there is pleasure and satisfaction in a much deeper place. And sometimes they're hard to discern. They were for Augustine.
And here in this moment, would you listen enough to your soul? Might there be a prayer that emanates from deep within that says, God, I hear the whisper. I recognize divine love. It might be hard to believe that the God of the universe really loves you. But the unfathomable mystery of God is that God is a lover who actually wants to be loved. So it's not just about loving you. He actually longs to be loved. He gave us his son to facilitate that connection. We break bread and drink wine to remember the broken body, the blood spilled out, the broken heart of God's Son over sin, but the healing celebration of resurrection that gives us an opportunity for life. What would it be like to live life loved? You've got two options. Deny it, disassociate from that deep longing, push it as far away as possible, and live a shallow experience as a human being. Or feel it rage within you, wild and passionate, and let it lead you to deep places with God. Father, thank you for others who've gone before us and who we can identify with. Thank you that you've given them words to put on paper to prompt us to give words to what we sense and feel, know in deep places. God, our desire has always been as a church not to just be another group that organizes and just perpetuates some kind of plastic experience. Our desire has been to walk in faith, to trust you, and to boldly seek a deep, intimate connection with you. God, connect us with that longing. Let us not be satisfied with mediocrity. Show us your love. In Jesus' name.